Hello and welcome to this town hall event marking 2011 Hours Against Hate campaign. I would like to begin by introducing the special envoy to monitor and combat anti-Semitism, Hannah Rosenthal, and the special representative to Muslim communities, Farah Pandith, Hannah Rosenthal. Hannah Rosenthal was sworn in as special envoy to monitor and combat anti-Semitism on November 23, 2009. Sparked by the work and experience of her father, a rabbi and Holocaust survivor, and her own experience studying to become a rabbi, Hannah Rosenthal has led a life marked by activism and a passion for social justice. Before joining the State Department, Ms. Rosenthal was executive director of the Chicago Foundation for Women, where she led one of the largest women's funds in the world. Prior to that, she was executive director of the Jewish Council for Public Affairs for 5 years, where she worked on domestic and international policy for the organized Jewish community in North America. Ms. Rosenthal also served as Midwest Regional Director of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services during the Clinton administration. Farah Pandith was appointed special representative to Muslim communities in June 2009. Her office is responsible for executing Secretary Clinton's vision for engagement with Muslims around the world on a people-to-people and organizational level. Prior to this appointment, she was senior advisor to the Assistant Secretary of State for European and Eurasian Affairs, where she was responsible for policy oversight for integration, democracy, and Islam. She also worked on issues relating to countering violent Islamic extremism. Before joining the Department of State, she served as the Director for Middle East Regional Initiatives for the National Security Council, coordinating U.S. policy on Muslim world outreach and the broader Middle East North Africa initiative. Prior to joining the NSC, Special Representative Pandith was Chief of Staff for the Bureau for Asia and the Near East for the U.S. Agency for International Development. Welcome, Hannah and Farah.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone.
It's very quiet in here.
Yeah, really
you guys are
is.
Very attentive. We're not going to give you a lecture, okay? This is going to be a fun afternoon, and we want to thank you very much for taking some time to share with us, and we're really especially looking forward to the questions and answers. What we thought we'd do in just a few minutes is tell you how we met and tell you how this campaign got started. Hannah and I have very different jobs. You heard our long bios. Thank you very much for that. And you know that we have different mandates, and the Secretary of State has asked us to work on important issues, but in different ways. So I had not met Hannah when I received a phone call from her office saying that Hannah really needed to speak to me urgently. And so, of course, I said, please come up. I'm in my office. And Hannah comes up, and she gives me a hug, and she says, and I have to say to you, this was at the time when we had just been hearing about what happened in Times Square, the plot that was thankfully foiled. But she came and she gave me a hug, and she said, I want to be of help to you. And she said, the messenger matters, Farah. And I know that what has happened in Times Square is going to mean that many people are going to look at the religion of Islam in a strange way, and they're going to hold Muslims accountable for something that has nothing to do with the religion of Islam. She said, how can I help? That's Hannah Rosenthal.
So we went to a conference in Kazakhstan. Don't put it on your bucket list. It was a very long flight. We went to a conference that was put on by the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, one of the leading regional groups on the globe. And what's wonderful about the OSCE is that they have a focus on human dimension. And they actually care about human rights and tolerance. By the way, the word tolerance does not mean we'll put up with you. In the diplomatic world, tolerance means mutual respect and acceptance and pluralism. And so please understand, we were at a tolerance conference. And I wrote the official U.S. statement condemning anti-Semitism And Farah wrote the official statement condemning Islamophobia, is how it was worded at the conference. And the night before the conference, we decided to swap speeches. And so when the conference began with a focus on hatred of Muslims, I was sitting in the US chair, and when they called on the United States, I introduced myself. My name is Hannah Rosenthal. I'm the special envoy on global anti-Semitism, and I want to condemn in the strongest words possible all that's going on that is increasing hatred of Muslims. And then when the next session focused on the subject of anti-Semitism, the same thing happened. And Farah spoke as the representative for engagement to Muslim communities around the world, condemning in the strongest words possible anti-Semitism. The message was strong, and at these conferences there are a lot of statements written and spoken. And so when you do something different, it may catch attention, and it did. But there also was the message that in addition to the profound message we were saying, it mattered who said it. And that by having unusual suspects speaking, you have a greater impact. And that's how we've been operating ever since.
So what we heard from people at that conference was that that was really powerful, that the United States delegation made such a bold move. Now, for those people who are not in government, it doesn't seem like such a bold move. But trust me when I tell you, in government, we don't usually see this kind of thing. But what they also said, what civil society said to me in my job and Hannah in hers, was you can't stop there. This can't be a one-off conference in Kazakhstan in which the United States makes such a bold statement and then does nothing with it. So what did we decide to do? We thought a lot about how we can think about an action-oriented campaign that was going to do something for a generation that the president and the secretary has talked a lot about, a generation that is under the age of 30 worldwide, that are people who want to be active, people who want to think about their world in a new way, that want to build partnerships of mutual respect, and to do something that really was going to take hold of an opportunity to use technology in new ways. And so we developed this idea of a campaign, 2011, Hours Against Hate, and in your hands, I see a lot of you have a package, a toolkit on that campaign. But we decided to launch it virtually so that anyone in the world could take hold of this campaign and make it theirs. So Hannah and I went back to the OSCE in February of this year and spoke to all of the ambassadors at the OSCE and said, we did this in Kazakhstan last year, and this year, the year 2011, we're going to seed this initiative so that the world can take hold of it and create a better place.
And so we thought about having people do something instead of just talk about it. And that's really what the campaign is about. It's a global campaign. It's a virtual campaign. And it's a campaign that's totally accessible. If you go on the website, you'll see people speaking all different languages. You might even understand some of them. And it's people saying, I'm going to pledge a certain amount of hours. Hi, I'm a Muslim, and I'm going to pledge 5 hours to work in a Jewish clinic. Hi, I'm a Roman Catholic, and I'm going to pledge 3 hours in a Baha'i food pantry, etc. People are engaged. We have embassies that are taking this and running with it. We have non-governmental organizations. You will note on the logo, nowhere on it does it say United States Department of State. It is just out there. So we want to encourage you to take it and make it your own. This is about deeds, not just words. And the theory of the campaign is to encourage people, young people, but we'll take some of the rest of you as well, myself included, and pledging hours to serve and volunteer at an organization that serves people that don't look like you, that don't pray like you, and don't live like you. And people, particularly young people, get it everywhere we've gone.
And we've gone to 3 countries to launch this. We've been to Azerbaijan, we have been to Turkey, and we've been to Spain. And we picked those countries very particularly because they have histories of pluralism. They have histories of different communities working side by side. And what was remarkable to us was that while, of course, an older generation said it's about time that something like this happened, it was the young people that fled forward and moved their ideas and their interest online. And so when you go to the Facebook webpage, you see campaigns that have started at universities. You see these NGOs. You see young people taking it and making it their own. Why? Because these young people do not want to live in a world in which there is no mutual respect. We have seen enough. The speech that each of our speeches in the OSCE ended with the same paragraph. Hate is hate. And hate is hate. We do not want to look at a future in which we continue this momentum in which a new generation is picking up the baggage of the past. What we're hoping to do as we look at the demographics worldwide is to anchor this in a generation that believes in themselves, believes in a future, and underscores what both the president and the secretary can say to live up to their God-given potential and to do more for themselves. We want to be helpful in that effort.
And using the technology that young people know so well, and I'm just learning, has caught on. While we were traveling in Azerbaijan, Sarah, who was traveling with us, taught me how to tweet. And we tweeted, and then we did a program, and I came back, and like 100 people, young people all over the world, were following me. I still don't know how they found me, but this is how the communication is happening, and we need look no further than our television sets to see what that kind of communication has burst forward in the world. And so we're very excited that this campaign, which provides people around the globe something to do. We recognize that young people, by that we have focused on 30 and younger. Neither of us are that, right?
I wish. Okay. I really do.
My children aren't. That they don't have disposable income to write a check to an organization, which has been the model of philanthropy and activity in so many places. They don't yet have an expertise from their life experiences to help an organization perhaps organize, but they have time, and every hour matters. And so what we have learned here in the United States is it is part of our culture to volunteer time. It is not anywhere else that we've been. Pretty fundamental questions like, well, how do you volunteer? And so when an individual is trying to find a group of people that aren't part of their community, it takes some work. And in that work, they're building a relationship. And isn't that what the goal of the State Department is to wage peace through relationships? So the European Union has designated 2011 as the year of volunteerism because they recognize this is something missing in their culture. And this is a campaign that is going to help them in showing people how to go about volunteering.
So before we turn the podium back to you, we would like to just give you our, I see some of you tweeting out there. So the hashtag is #2011AgainstHate. We'll come back to the podium at the end, but thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
We will now show a video from Secretary Hillary Clinton about this campaign.
Since becoming Secretary of State, I've traveled to nearly every corner of the globe. Wherever I go, I make a point to meet not only with government officials, but also with citizens, especially with young people, because I want to hear their ideas about how we can find new ways to come together, support new foundations of understanding, and build hope for a better future. More and more, I see communities and people turning their backs on old boundaries and barriers, and finding new ways to bridge all kinds of divides. That's the idea behind 2011 Hours Against Hate, a campaign to promote respect across lines of culture, religion, class, and gender. Together, we are asking people from around the world to volunteer 2,011 hours in the year 2011 on behalf of someone who doesn't look like you, live like you, or pray like you. We think it can be important to learn about another religion, to volunteer in a different community, or to reach out to people from another culture, and to find out how they live. So I urge all of you to join this campaign. Stand up and speak out against hate. Visit our Facebook page, 2011, that's 2011, Hours Against Hate, to learn more. Because more than dialogue and conversation, it's time for action. So let's join together and seize this moment. Let's chart a new course for the future. We can only do it if we do it together.
I would now like to introduce Tad Stanky, who is the Director of Policy and Programs for Human Rights First. Tad joined Human Rights First in January 2008 as Director of the Fighting Discrimination Program and currently serves as Director of Policy and Programs. Prior to joining Human Rights First, Tad worked at the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom from 2000 to 2007, where he served as Deputy Executive Director for Policy, as well as Acting Executive Director in 2002 and 2007. Tad led the Commission's effort to strengthen U.S. foreign policy to advance the right to freedom of religion and belief. He participated in fact-finding missions in Asia, the Middle East, and Europe, and served on official U.S. delegations to human rights conferences of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe and the United States. Welcome, Tad.
Thank you, Irene, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak a little bit today. So I was asked to make a few comments about what this campaign means from a human rights and a civil society perspective, and I came up with 4 points, really, to make. One is that combating prejudice and hatred is an extremely important aspect of protecting human rights. Hatred, prejudice, this is the climate in which we find all too often acts of discrimination and violence occurring. An act of violence can terrorize a community, and it can prevent its members from exercising their rights. In my work at Human Rights First, I've met people, African students in St. Petersburg, who were afraid to leave their rooms. Jews from Belgium who were afraid to wear their yarmulkes out in the street. Gay and lesbian activists from Uganda who, in standing up publicly to fight for their right to life, knew that they were putting their life at risk by doing that. Muslim women in Austria who expected to be harassed out in the streets when they're wearing hijab and who knew that they weren't going to get a job as a clerk in a store because it would be too public for somebody like that. Christians in Saudi Arabia, Hindus in Pakistan, the list goes unfortunately on and on, which leads me to my second point, which is that hatred and bigotry are not confined to any particular country or region or any particular community. It's a global problem, and it affects many communities. And when I describe what we do in our fighting discrimination program, it's quite a mouthful: combating racism, xenophobia, anti-Semitism, anti-Muslim bigotry, homophobia, and it goes, there's more. And when you realize that every group is a minority somewhere, you understand that this implicates all of us. And there are differences among different types of hatred, but what we find time and time again is that while there might be distinct problems, many times the solutions are shared. And that brings me to my third point, which is that the strategies to combat hatred need to be inclusive ones. It needs to focus on governments, because public officials and police when they're part of the problem, it makes the work of protecting human rights, protecting communities, protecting lives, all that more difficult. And it requires leadership, public officials to speak out against acts of intolerance and violence. It requires law enforcement to investigate and prosecute crimes of hatred. And it requires leadership and political will to bring police and politicians and communities together, to work together to address these problems. But how do you find that leadership and political will? Well, part of it is diplomacy, and part of it is what the State Department does and what Hannah and Farah do and others at the Department to speak to other governments. And part of it is groups like us that are continually providing recommendations and, shall we say, encouragement to the Department to do more, or to do something different, or to do something better. But there's a key ingredient, a critical ingredient, that also has to be part of the strategy, and that's really what we're talking about today, which is my final point, is that you need to engage people everywhere on this problem, right? There's no one community can or should be left alone to deal with this sort of problem. As was mentioned before, and I couldn't agree more, when somebody speaks up, when one community speaks up for another community, that gets attention. When a broad array of people speak up for a community, people who you wouldn't expect to have seen, that gets attention, that gets noticed. And people everywhere can both speak up and reach out. And the great thing about this campaign is that it combines both. You can speak up online, you can make your pledge known, and you can reach out. You're encouraged to reach out and do something and reach out to a community that's different than yourself. And this is another thing that we find in our work, and that is that what happens online is increasingly more and more important. This also gets noticed. This also can help shape the debate and shape actions by governments and by communities. But people also need to do things together. And again, when communities do things together, and it doesn't have to be solve the Middle East peace together or solve differences between, you know, one religion or another. It can be cleaning up something in the neighborhood or practical things that just bring people together, different communities together, to actually do something together. And that helps build the sorts of bridges that then can be communicated and hopefully build the kind of political will for governments to address these problems. So thank you very much.
Hello again. Let me introduce myself more formally. My name is Irene Oh, and I am director of the Peace Studies program here at the George Washington University, and also professor in the Religion Department. I've been asked to speak about why a Peace Studies program and academia generally would want to support an initiative like 2011 Hours Against Hate. In my opinion, one of the most important goals of a college education is to teach students so that they will become thoughtful citizens of our communities, our society, and the world. In order to do so, students must not only acquire the intellectual skills to comprehend and analyze our increasingly complex society, but also acquire the leadership skills to initiate and to carry out the changes that will better our lives here and lives abroad. These two aspects of learning, the book learning and the service learning, are best achieved when combined in such a way that students can relate what they've read and discussed and wrote about in the classroom to the world about them. And I have to admit that academia has been rightly criticized for not engaging in this interaction enough. But I think that is changing. Students should not only be able to do the learning in the classroom, but they can also take their experience from outside the classroom and use it to think critically about the texts that they encounter in class. Students in my Ethics and World Religions course, for example, not only learn about Islam from articles and documentaries they encounter in the classroom, but they're also able to filter the constant news media about Islam and Muslims in a thoughtful and engaged way. Initiatives such as these are critical for the cross-cultural relationships that are and will continue to be so necessary in our lives. Working with and for people who are different from us towards shared goals is one of the best ways for us to end discrimination that worsens unnecessary conflict in this world. So I beseech you, college students especially, to use their experience at the university not only to learn in the classroom and to view their activities as separate worlds, but to try to combine them to improve our society. There are two students who I would like to introduce who I think are doing this in an especially exemplary way, and they are Danica Brown and E.K. Umez-Ironi. Danica Brown, from the Black Student Union, is also student body senator-elect. E.K. Umez-Ironi is the incoming Black Student Union Director of Membership. I would like to introduce them and have them both come to the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone. Ignorance is a state of mind that divides. If we claim to live in these United States, then what perpetuates hate must be resisted. Once again, my name is E.K. Chukwu Mezzanini.
And my name is Danica Brown. We represent the Black Student Union of the George Washington University. The Stop the Hate campaign addresses an issue that has been pervasive throughout American history, based on the idea that we cannot coexist with what is different. A central tenet of the BSU has been and always will be to create an environment where differences can be embraced. In 2007, the BSU led a collaborative campaign entitled Stop the Hate. Back then, we faced nooses across university campuses, the incarceration of the Jena Six, and rising anti-Islamic sentiment in America. The BSU created a space for the student voice to be heard through the use of social media and traditional protest methods.
Today, the BSU has continued in that spirit of unification. When faced with an anti-affirmative bake sale, we felt that while the First Amendment guarantees the freedom of speech, it does not guarantee that all voices in the conversation are heard. In addition to holding a nonviolent educational protest, we hosted a forum facilitated by experts to educate the opposing sides. Disagreement can no longer divide, but it must always call us to remember our collective, common American heritage. The past and present have shown us that campaigns are seasonal, but hate is not, and thus the tools to resist hate should not be either. It is not about reacting, but rather proactive engagement of all parties, regardless of race, creed, gender, or sexual preference.
The Black Student Union of the George Washington University pledges its commitments to the efforts of the Stop the Hate campaign.
As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once said, we are caught in an inescapable web of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Thank you.
Okay, enough with speeches. I have been asked to moderate a question and answer session. So we have a microphone in the center. So I would encourage all of you to get up and fire away with your questions. And I'm very happy to take my prerogative and ask an initial question to both Farah and Hannah. We see here in the United States a number of acts of intolerance playing out across the news, you know, on a fairly regular basis. And I'm wondering if you could just talk a little bit about what that means for your work abroad and how you talk about that and how you see what's happening in the United States connected to what's happening around the world.
Well, I will say that while we're in the State Department and we sit at the table of foreign policy, we, of course, care a great deal about what's happening in our country and are following it very closely. With pain, I think. I think that when we think about what it means to be an American, we have certain values and high ideals that we all worry may be getting frayed when we see acts of hatred and such intolerance happening. And it can be against a wide variety of vulnerable groups. It can be as immediate as what happened in Detroit or Dearborn, Michigan last week, and it can be over the years as the examples of the students. It seems that hatred just has a life of its own. And I think that we need to be looking at our tolerance education and our messages to make sure we're changing as the world is changing, and that we're making sure that we're not just using communication tools that are different, but I think people hear messages differently now. And they hear so many messages that they can get confused. The good side of the technology is it can reach people and it's free. The bad side is hate speech can be used. And we don't want to in any way say people don't have a right to say things. People have a right to be stupid and hateful. But it isn't good enough to protect their right to speech if we don't condemn it. And so when you're on a listserv or you're on a tweet or whatever the technology is, and you see bad messages coming through, you have to realize that part of dedicating your time and pledging your time to 2011 Hours Against Hate or whatever campaign you want to call it that confronts hate, you have to condemn that speech. There was a time that I can remember, I'm old enough, that if somebody at a dinner party or a comic on a stage told a joke at someone else's expense, that person would have been marginalized. They might have lost their jobs for intolerance as a comic. And people confronted it. People were uncomfortable. It was unacceptable to tell the kind of jokes or make the kind of comments that we're seeing made. On campuses, we're seeing it made by government candidates and leaders, and it's something that needs to be condemned.
So, you know, the work that we do on the ground is overseas, and my mandate is to work on a people-to-people level. Everything that I do is grassroots, so my work is community-to-community globally. So I engage with Muslims in Muslim-majority countries and Muslims that live as minorities in parts of the world. And as somebody who is an American and is a Muslim, and I understand, obviously, that there is no contradiction between either, I also understand very clearly the values of our Constitution and what our Constitution has given us and the equal rights under the law. Now, as Americans, we can understand that what's taking place. We have the filter, we have the know-how to understand that when a preacher that has 50 people in his church says something, it doesn't reflect all of America. We get that. We're Americans. But when you go overseas, it is very hard to frame the issues that are happening in our country because they don't have the experience of living in our nation. Many people have not read our Constitution. Many people don't know that the man who did something bad in one part of the country or the woman that said something horrible doesn't represent all Americans. It makes my job, to answer your question, extremely hard. The amount of time that I spend talking about our country, I'm very proud to be an American, and I have a lot of really wonderful things to say about our nation. I have to spend time, however, speaking about some of the challenges that our nation is going through right now. And you talked about in your speech it not just being about religion. It's not about what color skin you have, what color eyes you have, what color hair you have, who you pray to, or what your gender is. It is about what's happening inside and what we are bringing outside to make and corrupt communities around America that then reflect to the world what they believe America to be. We are better than that. Our nation is stronger than that. We have gone through incredible hardships, and the students that spoke today brought up one of the many challenges our nation has gone through. But it is unbelievably hard to try to put forward partnerships and dialogue and relationship building on a wide range of things. Yes, I happen to be the special representative to Muslim communities, but my colleagues at the Department of State also have to deal with being able to try to explain how what one person is doing and is being carried by the media all day, every day, as if it's the only thing that's happening in our nation. It's extremely hard, and it prevents us from doing the kind of work that we have been asked to do.
I want to just add one thing, and that is another thing that we do here in America so well is we know how to build coalitions and partnerships so that if people are interested in fighting poverty, you have representatives of many, many religions and many community groups together. And where we travel, people don't do that by instinct. And so a lot of what we do, if a community says, I'm very concerned. I mean, obviously, when I travel, I'm dealing mainly with the Jewish community. And if they'll say, people don't believe that anti-Semitism is current events. They think it's in a way back in history. How do we deal with this? And I say, well, have you gotten together with the local church? And the answer isn't because people aren't smart. They go, what a good idea. It isn't how that culture thinks. I think it's the most important export we have is our ability to build partnerships and build coalitions so people are speaking out on behalf of people who may be voiceless. Just wanted to add that.
So I don't see a long line at the microphone yet. I don't know.
The microphone's
it's in the middle of the... Yeah.
If you could just say who you are, please.
Okay, I'm Cindy Lacoby, and I am with the State Department, actually, in U.S. Information Agency, what used to be USIA, public diplomacy. I've been doing this kind of thing for a while. I have a lot of issues I work on. One of the things I've noticed, it's a pretty common trend through getting people to change their behavior is, and this is going to sound crass, and I'm sorry, but it's an economic advantage. Yeah, you can stop discrimination because it's the right thing to do, and yes, it is. But it's also economically beneficial to do so. It's economically beneficial to stop using police or armies to fight wars. It's economically beneficial to use that money in other ways. It's economically beneficial to listen to the input of all kinds of brains. I mean, we finally started listening to women, the other half of this guy. We need to start listening. Other countries need to be told, and it ought to be a message. Not only should you do this because it's the right thing to do, part of the reason America, even though we have our problems, is strong is because we listen to input from all kinds of people, ugly people, pretty people, fat people, thin people, Muslims, Jewish. It doesn't matter. You know that it makes economic sense to listen to everyone, and I'm wondering if there has been a study that either George Washington University has done or the Peace Institute has done or somebody has done that talks about the economic benefits of not discriminating. Has that been looked at all? Does that make sense?
Yes, yes, it does. And actually, there have been some studies, interestingly, done at business schools, which is appropriate, to talk about how quickly teams, management teams that consist of a diversity of perspectives can come up with more creative solutions to problems than groups that tend to be monolithic in their outlook. Mm-hmm. So yes, there have been studies to back up the push to diversify. It's not just that it's nice and we should all hold hands, but yes, there is kind of an economic incentive as well.
Yeah, I wish that was more publicized. I wish that was more known, than instead of just this is the right thing to do and kind of a lecture circuit, that it's, wow, you can take advantage of everything your society has to offer if you, you know, if you're a little more peaceful, if you listen to people. You can take advantage of the ideas that people have. It's just more of a positive message rather than such a, this is the right thing to do. It's more than the right thing to do. You can help your society grow. You can help your economy to grow.
I think there's nothing wrong with making an argument out of enlightened self-interest. And
exactly.
I think that often when we're making arguments, it is the right thing to do, and we talk about whatever our background is, the morals and values that we've been given would fight for, you know, ending poverty or whatever the issue is. But we also need to make the argument out of enlightened self-interest, because you're absolutely right. It helps build the political will, but it also is an argument that has merit. Mm-hmm. Thanks for bringing that up.
Yes.
Hey, good afternoon. Jihad Saleh with Islamic Relief USA. First, I want to thank you for giving the opportunity for your two youth leaders who I think have left the meeting.
They're right behind you.
Behind me. Really inspiring words. The activities of the BSU here, you know, particularly myself as a former, you know, director for the BSU and at my undergraduate and graduate institutions, I'm always glad to see those organizations taking the lead, especially for a diverse group of communities to help expand this notion of pluralism and participation in our country. Two questions interrelated. One, this is 2011, so we're approaching, you know, very much the 10th anniversary of 9/11. So I'm wondering how a lot of organizations are already planning how to, you know, we have to kind of take the perspective of the lowest common denominator of what could happen, and how is civil society, NGOs, are working together to protect communities, to message to communities, and to organize. Which you're making a call, I think, is very much part of that process, which is important. But how specifically does the 2011 against Hours Against Hate going to coordinate around that? I know you're really looking at us, the civil society, NGOs, to really take hold and interact with each other, but how is there going to be some communication and organizing around that particular date and event? And then two, with that, you know, being formerly, you know, government staffer responsible for advising congressional members on Muslim engagement, I know they take that information and message it back, which is really important. How can we be of assistance to you, which in your context of State Department and President Obama, with the right information, the right stories that you need for that informational feed?
Jihad, thank you very much for that. And for those of you who don't know Jihad, he's put a lot of work in the last few years in building coalitions and doing a lot on Capitol Hill and working with young people who are interested in issues of pluralism and democracy. And I want to thank you for your work. Let me say to you also a big thank you for your offer to be of help. And I say this to everybody in the audience. We are looking for ideas. We don't know everything. We don't know every group that we need to be out there communicating with. Because our job is to communicate overseas, we have very robust relationships with our embassies, and we have moved this campaign out overseas. And so again, if you go to the Facebook page, you will see many of our embassies that have taken it on and really brought it, as Hannah said, there's no State Department logo on here because we really wanted to make it a campaign for people, by the people, for their future. And we're just sort of a catalyst to get it going. So if you have ideas here in the United States of groups that you think that we should connect with, that we should engage with to tell them more about this campaign.
Or you should engage with.
Yes, that's even better. That would be really terrific. Vis-a-vis the comment about 9/11. Now, look, I want to be very, very clear about something. The way in which our country has amazingly been thinking about this anniversary to honor the victims of 9/11, to spend some time reflecting about the pain and suffering of those families, to think about ways that we can build coalitions worldwide, to talk about issues of mutual respect. Lots of things are happening organically. They're not happening because the U.S. government is telling people to do it, and that, I think, is the strongest possible message, that they're happening in every state of the nation. There are many ways in which we could hope to see organic organizations and individuals use this campaign as they think about issues of pluralism and mutual respect. But to be absolutely clear with you, there isn't some sort of goal setting that we're putting out there to make sure that this is married in with 9/11, because it isn't just about the 10th anniversary. This is a very important year in many ways. But let's remember very clearly that while our country was attacked on 9/11, the ideology of Al-Qaeda has affected countries all over the world on different days in different years. And that is very important. So it is not just about America being the victim of the AQ ideology. It is Bali. It is Amman. It is the UK. It is Spain. And that happened in different ways at different times. Please, come on.
Hi, my name is Danika. I spoke earlier. My question is, we understand that hatred now amongst our generation exists, but how do we counteract the hatred that is learned and that is taught in homes of children to children across America? They're so young and impressionable, and we all grow up to be the people who are going to lead the conversation forward. How do we influence that generation?
Well, you influence it at home, where children receive their first messages. You pay attention to what the schools are teaching. I fondly remember quizzing my girls when they were young for a history test. And we got to a point on the history test on the Inquisition in Spain. And I'm looking at it. I said, this is all you learned on the Inquisition? The word Jew isn't even there. And since 1492, Jews and Muslims haven't been there because they were kicked out. Excuse me, you know, I'm telling this to my kids, like they're gonna know the difference. So I marched into the school and I said, this is unacceptable. Now, of course, there are people on the other side who wanna remove, you know, scientific lessons from school books, but to show how important textbooks are and the training of teachers, and we have to make it important. Schools are run by local school boards. They're not run by the federal government. And it is a way of grassroots organizing that can make a difference. But sometimes we become paralyzed because it seems so big and so bad. That's kind of what was behind also 2011 Hours Against Hate, is don't be paralyzed. Just give an hour. Just spend a day looking at textbooks or how our universities are training the teachers. That becomes really important. It becomes fundamental. And never mind also how educational television how that is sending messages to kids. Is tolerance something that we value as important as learning the alphabet or learning algebra? And I think it should be. I think it should come back to being fundamental lessons that kids are taught as children. The minute they hit school, it is put out there as a fundamental, important value.
I just want to say two quick things. I want to go back to what Tad said earlier about communities come together about different things. So whether you're picking up trash in the neighborhood or you're working with different groups on a different project, making those connections in a multitude of ways helps on the issue of diversity anyway. So you're not just approaching somebody who's different than you to say, hey, we have a problem with pluralism or mutual respect, but we're talking about other things that we as a community can do together. The other piece that I just want to touch on is lexicon, how we speak about each other. What are the words that we're using? And what do we allow society to find acceptable? And I mean, I can't speak for every group out there, but I have heard all kinds of interesting phraseology and descriptions being used of different ethnicities and different races and different religions that I think to myself, I don't think that would be a nice thing to be called if I were, you know, and you have to be bold. You have to, as the secretary just said, stand up and speak out. You can't let things like that slide. When somebody uses a term or says something negative, that's the time that you stand up and say, in a nice way, listen, that doesn't work, and this is why.
I'd like to add to that. There have actually been studies that have shown that the most important thing that you can do to encounter racism and discrimination in young children, because children pick this up so early, is that you as a parent or as some other moral authority in this young person's life is to address it directly. Mm-hmm. And these studies are fascinating. You can have children in diverse school settings. You can have them watch Sesame Street episodes. But if no adult actually engages with the child in conversation to talk about racism and discrimination, then the child continues to harbor these beliefs. So again, candid and frank conversations with young people from the earliest ages is vital.
Well, and children, of course, pick up a lot from their parents by osmosis and other people around mm-hmm. them, and you can certainly engage them in activities from very early on. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Atiyah Nasser, but we're actually taking questions live online. So we have one question off of Twitter, which is from Ruben ESP. That's his Twitter handle. The question is, should the U.S. have diplomatic relations with nations that support the killing of minority groups?
Well, can I just say something about the person who just read off Twitter? The logo is not up here, but it's on your toolkit. And the person who came up with that logo is this wonderful young woman right there. So she's very talented in many ways. Do you want to take that or?
Well, I think it's great that Twitter's following this. Thank you. Thank you, whoever you are and however you found us. We have diplomatic relations with 194 countries. None of them are perfect. Some of them, their human rights records are horrific. And we do a very good job of documenting that and making that public through our human rights report, through our international religious freedom report, and through statements that our government leaders make here and abroad. There are times when it is more important to engage when countries are doing bad things than before. And there are times when breaking off a relationship is vital because it signals, it's a sanction, and it signals not only disapproval by the United States, but by the international community. It is a case-by-case basis. So it can't be answered broad stroke. But I can tell you, we work in a department where there are entire bureaus that all day long are debating that very issue on a given situation in a given country. I work in the Bureau of Human Rights, and so it is what we do. And we sit at the public policy table and make the argument that human rights, and frankly, as Tad said, hatred is a fundamental abuse of human rights. And we sit at the table saying, this should be the first thing we talk about, and somebody else says, this is the first thing we should be talking about. So on a case-by-case basis, it is raised during our relationship, and relationships are very complicated.
Ike Chukwu Umezuanin, I spoke earlier. So I was just curious, a lot of the conversation is centered around, I guess, what we do once we feel a sense of responsibility to serve our communities, to serve the world at large. But I was curious, do you have any ideas of how you first instill or create that sense of responsibility within people before they can go out and start doing things?
Well, you give them things to do. That's really what's behind 2011 Hours Against Hate. It's something really simple. And since you guys are on Twitter, obviously, and Facebook and your computers all the time anyway, you're amazingly connected. That's what globalization really is. It's a way of saying you're going to use the things you do normally every day to do something to advance fighting intolerance. So motivation is making things easy, simple, and doable.
The other thing is, frankly, I mean, in the work that I do, I spend most of my time overseas. And at last count, I was more than 40 countries around the world. And no matter where I am, whether it's a rural place or it's an urban place, whether it's an affluent country or not, whether I'm speaking to an audience that's extremely well-educated or maybe not so much, whether it's men, whether it's women, no matter where I am in the world, and I talk to the generation under the age of 30, I hear in their voices their commitment and their desire to do something bigger and bolder than what's happening around them. They need to have their voices lifted up. They need to have platforms in which they can speak. And we, as government, must do as much as we can to be the convener and the facilitator and the intellectual partner with the ideas that we hear on the ground. And so when we hear people respond to President Obama talking about mutual respect, and when we hear people responding to Secretary Clinton talking about her belief in this next generation, we must do all that we can to find ways to actually activate their interest and their ideas to build a stronger world. I'm not being Pollyanna here. I absolutely believe in this generation. And I could not do my job if I didn't. And I can tell you from looking at the audience right now with people who are going like this and the responses that we've gotten in our work, especially on this campaign, people are looking for ways to channel their interest in their future. And this is one of many ways. And so on the issue of responsibility, it's the issue of action, action forward. I think this is our last question, yeah? Okay.
I just want to add something. One of the great things about the internet is that it connects you immediately with all the things that are already going on. And there's no, I mean, there are any number of things out there for people to connect to.
Hi, my name is Afshan Khoja, and I represent South Asian Americans Leading Together. We've just started a campaign called An America for All of Us, where we're actually dealing with some of the similar ideas.
Give us the website so that people know.
It's saalt.org. Okay. So please do join the campaign. It's again, for community engagement and things like that. But I think one aspect that we're trying to address also, and I feel like I should get your input on that, is that I think a lot of the division and this culture of hatred that's been created in the U.S. Has become worse in the past few years, and a big chunk of that is because of what we have allowed our elected representatives to get away with. So, you know, Peter King saying things like there are too many mosques in this country, or and you know, just these kind of statements have created a complete division, you know, within the country. And whereas, like, getting the community and getting the youth to sort of talk about, you know, creating unity and you know, harmony, I think there's a big need also to sort of get some accountability from our elected officials and tell them to just stop this complete ridiculous thing that's going on where you can get away with saying the things that you have. So, I mean, if you have any input on, like, how your campaign can address some of those things.
Well, I just want to say amen, if I may. I totally agree with that. I think holding people accountable who spew hatred is everybody's responsibility. Elected officials really listen to their voters, and they read their letters to the editor, and they monitor the phone calls and emails they're getting. And so it takes a second to let an elected official know that that was unacceptable. And it takes a second to let somebody in your class know that what they said is unacceptable, and it takes a second to stop yourself if all of a sudden you find yourself thinking a hateful thought. I mean, we were born not hating, and somewhere along the line we were all taught to hate. And so we all battled this because people different than us are different than us. But we need to battle it. We need to take the time and say it's unacceptable.
And I just want to say one point. I mean, you're seeing this from the American perspective of America, and you called out a couple of folks here in our country, but understand that publicly elected officials around the world are saying hateful things about other religions and races. And I've seen the increase. You're absolutely correct. You know, if you look at the number of swastikas that are being spray painted on, you know, on the sides of the streets, in cemeteries and whatnot all across Europe, it's appalling. When you see the kind of vile things that are being said in other parts of the world on gender issues, I mean, it isn't a nice place on the planet at the moment on these issues. But it isn't just okay to say that we're seeing the data points shift and there's an increase. What Hannah said is correct. You have to call out. But I am seeing, I think I want to just turn this just slightly, you are seeing organic responses to that kind of negativity by the kind of campaign that you started with others around the world who've said that isn't enough, and they are, in fact, calling out on their elected officials because they don't think it's acceptable to do that.
I just want to add that I have two grown daughters who often ask me, doesn't this depress you? You go around the world learning about hatred of Jews. You know, like, don't you get depressed? And I say, I get to do something about it. Yeah. I get to do something about it. And this campaign, this global campaign, when we travel to these countries and we meet with young people, it's, frankly, inspirational. They get it. They want a different world. They are committed to doing something about it. And in 5 minutes, they're going to be the majority of the population on the globe. So, as depressing as comments that go unanswered and events that go unanswered, is there are actually some people who are pushing back, and they happen to be young, and they're going to take care of me in my old age.
Okay, so I think we're out of time. I want to thank everyone again, Hannah, Farah, and Irene, and everyone here in the audience for coming today. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.